In reading the parable that Jesus wrote concerning the parable of the sower, it reminds me a great many things. One thing that comes to mind is that to every action, to everything that we do in this life, there is consequences. And I think the sower tells us a lot about the consequences that we can expect if we do the wrong thing in this life. It reminds me of a story that was told me several years ago. A gentleman owned a clothing store, a men's clothing store, matter of fact. And he was gone out to lunch. And when he came back from lunch, he was greeted by his employee. And the employee had a bandage around his hand. And before he could ask the employee what the bandage was doing around his hand, the employee said, "I've got good news for you." And the store manager said, "Well, what is that?" And he said, "You know that, you remember that ugly suit we've had here that we've had so many years that," and the manager says, "You talking about that pink and blue double-breasted monstrosity?" And he said, "Yeah, that's the one." And he said, "I thought we never would get rid of that thing." And the employee said, "Well, I sold it while you was out to lunch." And the manager said, "Well, that's good," said, "I didn't think we'd ever get rid of that thing." And he said, "By the way, what's the bandage doing on your hand?" He said, "Well," he said, "the guy that I sold it to," he said, "his guide dog bit me." Think about that for a minute. He sold that ugly suit to a blind man. Well, that wasn't very nice, but there again, you have the ideal that there's consequences to everything we do. And I believe Jesus taught a lot about consequences in the story of the parable. He talks about, as Brother Robbie read for us a while ago, a sower going out to sow his seeds. You know, we need to be sowing seeds. We do. As Christians, I believe in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, we read there about the fruit of the Spirit. But I think we could also use that fruit of the Spirit and liken that to seeds as well. We need to be sowing those kinds of seeds. We need to be sowing seeds of goodness and kindness and mercy and gentleness and compassion. And all of those things, even those things that the Apostle Peter speaks of in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 through 10. We need to be sowing brotherly kindness and a whole lot of seeds of love we need to be sowing. But one thing you don't ever want to be guilty of sowing, one seed, if you've got it in your seed bag, you need to get it out of there. Never, 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 ever be sowing seeds of discord among brethren. We're warned about that in God's Word, too. And there are consequences. We all know the consequences of that. But the sower that Jesus is talking about here has a lot to do with the type of soil that you choose to sow that seed in. And he begins by saying that the first seed was a seed that was sowed by the wayside. And by the way, the parable here even explains in Matthew 13:19, as well as in Luke 8 and verse 11. By the way, the lesson tonight is from Matthew 13. So if you have your Bibles with you, you can turn there and follow along. Matthew 13:18 through 23. In Matthew 13, as well as in Luke 8 and verse 11, he says that the seed is the Word of God. That's what the seed represents here. Now, he's talking about a physical thing, as Jesus oftentimes does when he talks of about a parable. A parable, after all, is an earthly story with a heavenly meaning, right? So here we find the first soil is the soil of the wayside. We might not use that word a whole lot today, wayside, but he's talking about soil that is hard, soil that is undesirable for planting. It can be well packed down. It's not soil that's been cultivated. It's not soil that's really suitable for seeds. And he begins, he says, when one hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the wicked one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is he who receives the seed by the wayside. The wayside, again, is the side of the path or hard, unsuitable ground. In Matthew 13:15, he says, "For the hearts of this people have grown dull." This is what Jesus said about their hearts. He said, "Their hearts have grown dull, their ears hard of hearing, and their eyes have closed." They simply had shut their mind and their hearing and their eyes to the word of God and would not hear. In this parable that we just read about the wayside, he said, the birds comes and they'll take those seeds away. The birds represent Satan. In fact, Jesus goes on to say in Luke chapter 8, those by the waysides are one who hears, then the devil comes and takes away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. A condition of being blinded by Satan to the gospel. We have an example of that in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 through 4, where the Apostle Paul says, writing to the Corinthian brethren, if our gospel is veiled, if it's hidden, the veil to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. Some choose to blind themselves from the gospel, from God's word. They put that veil or that blindness there before them. Sometimes they do it to themselves. And when they're blinded, they cannot see. And you can bet something else will take the place of that. We talked about in our Bible class this morning how that the Apostle Paul cautioned the Galatians. Excuse me. He cautioned the Galatians to not believe any other gospel that was preached, even though it was by an angel from heaven. Don't believe it. And we all know examples today of that which has happened. And people have believed those strange They have believed those strange doctrines, and it's caused them to perish, to be lost. Then there's this, we'll make it. Then there's the stony places. The second soil. Matthew 13:20-21. But he who receives the seed on the stony places, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy, yet has no root in himself, but endures only for a while. We've often been heard this over the years, that an emotional reception of the gospel can't be a good foundation. And that's happened sometimes. People emotionally accept it, but not for the right reason. Let me go on further and explain. In Acts chapter 2, verses 41 and 42, we have the example there of those who gladly received his word and were baptized. And that day, about 3,000 souls was added to them. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. The apostles' doctrine is Jesus' doctrine, by the way. And fellowship and breaking bread and in prayers. In James chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, here James says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. Are you like the stony places? When Christianity becomes hard and difficult, and things become hard and difficult, Do you give up? And then there's the ones that fell among the thorns.
Thank you, Blair.
I should have remembered to done that before, but I didn't. Thank you, Larry. Those of the that fell among the thorns, that's the third soil that's spoken of. In Matthew 13, verse 23, now he who receives the seed among the thorns is he who hears the word, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of the riches and pleasures of life, Luke chapter 8 and verse 14 says, chokes the word and it becomes unfruitful. There are three thorns that are explained in God's word. Three thorns we're going to talk about. First one is in 1 Timothy chapter 6 verses 9 through 10. Paul writing to Timothy says, but those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith, and in their greediness, and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. And in Matthew chapter 6, in verse 31 through 33, Jesus warns, therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For all these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need these things, but seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And then in Luke 21, verses 34, take heed to yourself, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing, drunkenness, and cares of this life, and that the day come upon you unexpectedly. Now, are you like the soil among the thorns? Has day-to-day life made you forget about eternity, about your soul, whether you're prepared to meet God in eternity or not? That would be like the thorns. Now, your Christianity is ineffective, according to John 15, verses 1 and 2, where Jesus says, I am the true vine. My Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that doth not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears, he prunes it that it may bear more. Then there's the good soil. The good soil, Jesus says in Matthew 13, verse 23, but he who receives the seed on good ground, is he who hears the word and understands, and who indeed bears fruit and produces, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Luke 8 and verse 15 says, but the ones that fell on the good ground are those having heard the word with a noble and good heart. They keep it, and they bear fruit with patience. And in Acts 17 and verse 11, we read, these, the Bereans, the Apostle Paul is talking about, were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness and searched the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. Note the importance of understanding in relationship to bearing fruit. We must understand, take it to heart, be serious about it, have it on our minds constantly, and we will bear fruit. Colossians chapter 1, verses 5 through 6. we read, "The word of truth of the gospel which has come to you is bringing forth fruit, as it is also among those among you since the day that you heard and knew the grace of God in truth." So what kind of fruit will one bear who hears the word, takes those things to heart, puts it into action in his life? What kind of fruit will he bear? Well, there's different kinds of fruit we read throughout God's word. There's the fruit of winning souls, Romans chapter 1 and verse 13. That's one of them. You'll win other Christians. What you say, what you do, and because they know the truth is in you. Then there's the fruit of practicing holiness, Romans chapter 6 and verse 23. You won't let the world dictate to you what you wear, how you talk, and how you behave. You're going to do that according to God's word. And then there's the fruit of sharing material things, Romans 15, verse 27, when you have opportunity to share with others. Then there's the fruit of the Spirit, Christ-like character, in other words, Galatians 5, 22 and 23. We talked about those at the beginning. And then there's the fruit of good works, Colossians 1 and verse 10. We'll be doing good things. And then there's the fruit of praise and thanksgiving. Are you grateful and thankful for all that God has given you, continues to give you? Hebrews 13, verse 15 reminds us of that. An important observation is that not all will bear the same amount. All of us will bear fruit if we do these things. But we might not all bear the same thing. Remember, Jesus said in Matthew 13:23, some bore 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Question is, are you like the good soil? That's the one we want to be like. We want to be the good soil. Jesus finished telling this parable of the sower by saying, he who has ears, let him hear. Matthew 13 and verse 9. Clearly, we learn that not all of those who have ears hear. They choose not to hear. It's important that we listen well when God's word is being proclaimed, for that is how faith is obtained, when we listen to God's word as it's being read. Romans 10 and verse 17, faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. How well have you listened to this parable of Jesus and his explanations? If you're like any of the other soils that we talked about tonight, the soil by the wayside, the stony ground, the thorny soil, the thorns, if you're like any of those, anything other than the good soil, which is what your life should be like as a Christian, but if it's anything otherwise, you need to repent today, while you still have time. It's our prayer that you will have good and noble hearts, that you will hear, you will examine God's word to see, you will understand and accept the gospel of Christ and his kingdom, which is what we want to do. Now, if you're here and you're not a member of the body of Christ, you can be. Again, as we said a while ago, by hearing God's word. Faith comes by hearing the word of God, Romans 10, 17. Then by being willing to repent, Luke 13, verse 3, as Jesus commanded that we all repent. By willing to confess Christ before men, Matthew 10, 32. Jesus said, if we'll do that, he'll confess us before his Father who is in heaven. And then finally, to be baptized with Christ, to be immersed with Christ, as we have examples of those in Acts chapter 2 and verse 38. And Jesus commanded in Mark 16 and verse 16, he who believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that doesn't believe will be condemned. And then we're to be faithful. Faithful. That's what we've been talking about tonight in bearing fruit and planting the good seeds. Being faithful all of our life, Romans 10, Romans 2 and verse 10. And then we're to always be found steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of our Lord as Christians. In 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 58. If you do these things, then heaven will be your home. If you haven't been doing those things, there's still time. You can repent and you can start doing those things this very day. We hope that you will. If you have any needs, come now as we stand and sing the invitations.